Dear all, please welcome with me Professor Ben Leong. Professor Ben Leong is Associate Professor of Computer Science with the School of Computing at NUS, National University of Singapore. From July 2014 to June 2019, he was Director of Experimental System and Technology Laboratory at the Ministry of Education. He is also currently Director of Artificial Intelligence Center for Educational Technologies at AI.SG, the Singapore National Artificial Intelligence Program, and also Director for the Center for Computing for Social Good and Philanthropy at the National University of Singapore School of Computing. Thank you very much to welcome with me Professor Ben Leong.
Thank you, Zijian. All right, very good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Good morning. Morning. Hello, morning. Okay, good. Thank you very much. First, I'd like to thank Xavier and ESSEC for inviting me to speak to you today. This is called the Imagination Week, right? So it's great to be here. So I must say first that if you hear me coughing, I actually just caught COVID with my wife a couple of weeks ago. I'm supposed to have recovered, but there's just a lingering cough, right? And I hope I can survive to the end of the talk today. So first, let me just tell you a bit more about myself. Hi, this is me, and this is my wife, who should be joining us soon when she gets her car parked. And then we have three kids, okay? So I've been at NUS as prof for, I think, 17 years now. So I don't look that old, I suspect, but I've been prof for about 17 years, okay? Generally, my students call me Prof Ben, right? So I'm happy to take questions from you, and you know, most of my students call me Prof Ben, okay? And so I was given this as the topic for the week, right? Okay? After thinking about this topic and about what I want to talk about, right? I would like to just do a little pop quiz. Okay, so yeah, you know this quote, right? Okay, so ask not what your country can do for you. Who actually said this? Yes, sir. Very good, JFK, right? So this is sort of the, I guess it came to mind when I was asked to speak. And actually there's another quote that I sort of liked. Okay, anybody knows where this came from? Anyone? Spider-Man, right? So actually, it's this guy called Uncle Ben, not Spider-Man, but okay. So I guess as a computer scientist, okay, confronted by the question of what can we do for society at large in big technology. What I wanted today is to share with you some stories. I guess everyone likes stories, right? Okay, so basically the question that I want to talk about is today is how we can possibly be able to do some good with tech skills, because what I do for a living is build software, okay? And with that, let me tell you a little story. Okay, tech skills. Okay, I guess you know the drill, right? So anyway, this story begins many, many years ago, okay? And in particular, this is August 2001, right? And this, in case you don't know what this is a small college, right? On the East Coast of the US where I went to grad school. So in 2001, right? I went back to, I left Singapore and I decided to go back to grad school, right? This is MIT near Boston, okay? And so obviously, you know, as you know, today I'm a professor of computer science, right? So back then I went to grad school in computer science, okay? So this is when I was at MIT. MIT is on this road called 77 Mass Ave, right? Okay? And basically, if you walk down Mass Ave, right, you will see this building. Okay, this is the Salvation Army. Anybody here is familiar with the Salvation Army? You know, you guys know Salvation Army, right? It's worldwide. It's sort of a church, right? And but the interesting thing about the Salvation Army is that the pastors, they have this uniforms and the pastor is called captain, you know? All right, so anyway, this is the Salvation Army homeless shelter that is just down the street from MIT. It's probably like, you know, you walk from MIT down the street, it's like 3 minutes maybe, okay? So you know, there's a little grocery store that you go to and then you can pass this place. Right, so anyway, the story goes that this is 2001, and I was back in grad school, and basically one of my friends, Ji John, who basically also went to grad school at MIT, a Singaporean guy and my good friend. He was walking, actually it wasn't me who was walking down the alley, that was him, right? And interestingly, he walked past this shelter and somehow, you know, he got accosted by the pastor that was captain, right? And so the pastor asked him and said, hey, you know, you MIT, right? You're smart, right? Okay? Can you do something for us, right? So he somehow, something possessed him and he said, yes, lah, okay? So what did he want us to do? Okay, so before we continue with the story, let me just give you a quick overview of what it's like. Okay, Singapore actually, I don't think we have homeless shelters, I'm not sure where they are, but US, there's quite a lot of homeless people. Boston is kind of cold, right? So what a homeless shelter does is that it provides housing, they have a place to stay for the homeless people. And interestingly, it's a 5-day-in, 3-day-out system, which means that you don't get to stay there, you know, permanently. You know, you can stay in the shelter 5 days, and then you need to, you know, go away for 3 days. But it's basically, they don't want to create a kind of a sense of permanence, or, you know, so people are incentivized to actually try to do their best to find permanent housing for themselves. So with a home shelter, it looks like this. And it's not just about a place to stay at night, right? They also provide meals. They have like dental services. I think they give out clothes, different stuff, but all kinds of different services that they provide. So this is the place where they eat, right? This is the kitchen where they cook. Okay. And what did this captain, who is a pastor of the shelter, the shelter is also a church, sort of like. Okay, so it's like many things in one. And what they wanted done, and what we built in the end, is this thing you see, okay? So, what's the problem? The problem is that they actually want to keep track of what's going on, what are the services that they're giving to the clients, who are homeless people, right? So, what you see here is that it's actually a card that they essentially issued to the homeless people, the card. And, okay, how many of you are old enough to remember this thing called the Palm Pilot? Palm Pilot. Okay, you're all very young. Okay. So prior to somebody hands up? Anybody? Okay, sorry, I think you're revealing your ages here. Okay, but anyway, prior to handphones and mobile phones, there is this device, handout device, which is called Palm Pilot. Okay. So we were quite ahead of our time, because what we did was that we built this, some software, okay, whereby you can attach a barcode scanner module to the Palm Pilot. Okay, and then we can use that device, right, to sort of take attendance. So what happens here is that when they eat at the canteen, right, canteen of this place, they were supposed to like write their names down in the sign-up sheet, right? Okay, unfortunately what happened was that they found out that Bill Clinton was having lunch there, so Mickey Mouse was having lunch there, you know. So basically the clients signed random names into the sheet, right? So with this particular card system, they can track what? They can track who went for lunch every day accurately. Okay. When they give socks, you know, or blankets or whatever to the people, they can track who took what. Okay. And actually, you know, they have beds. Okay. So they don't have rooms per se. They have this like humongous like a dormitory and then the beds there. It turns out that they also have this reservation system. So basically, you're homeless, right? You can sign up for a stay, right? And you can access it. You can stay there for 5 days at a time, and you go for 3 days, right? So what they used to have was a big book, right? Where they have signups, so you know who is staying in which bed, okay? But with the new system, okay, what we did was we built a web system, reservation system, so it's a hotel booking system, right? Which will allow them to reserve beds for the clients that they have. Okay, so this is my friend Ji John, who was the guy who was actually doing, who was, you know, accosted by the pastor and who agreed to the project, and he kind of dragged me into it, right? And this is me, much younger, okay, doing the you know, writing the code for this thing. And this is me, okay, that's me at home on the left, okay, my dorm room. I have a big, even back then, I had a big LCD monitor. And the right side is actually me installing the software in the homeless shelter itself. So they had a small server and a PC, right? And this is technically that was me, but I also roped in some of my fellow grad students to do this. And then this is what we built for the shelter. Okay, so this was done around 2002. So I went to MIT in 2001. I randomly agreed to do this, and we built this in 2002. So this is almost, it's actually more than 20 years, right? And this is what we did. Okay, so basically, I built software for a homeless shelter about 20 years ago, right? Back at MIT, right? And then fast forward another 5 years, right? Okay, so this is my school where I teach. So in five years after I went to grad school, I graduated, fortunately. And I came back to Singapore and became prof at NUS, right? So what happened then? Let me tell you the story continues, right? So my first year as prof, right? There is this random student, okay? It was an Indian boy who came to me and said, "Hey, prof, you know, we want to build software for the local charities." And in Singapore back then, the charities were called VWOs or voluntary welfare organizations. Today, actually, they've renamed themselves. They are called social service agencies, right? So there's this boy who came to see me and said, "Hey, prof, I want to do this." I'm like, "You serious?" Okay, I tell him what, right? You go and find yourself a couple of buddies, right? You find your team, you come back to me, right? And we talk, right? Okay, so frankly, I didn't think much of it. I mean, students say all kinds of random stuff all the time, right? They do, okay? But he came back, with, like three other Indian boys. So this a bunch of four Indian kids came and see me, right? I said, "Prof, to do this." I'm like, "Oh, really? Okay." So basically, okay, what I knew back then was that it's not enough. I mean, I need more people, okay? But with these four students seeing me, okay, to talk about what they want to do, I said, "Never mind. Okay, good. Let's try this, right?" So I actually, sent out an email to the whole, all the students. And we said, why don't we do this, okay? And about a group of like 13, 14 kids actually volunteered. And then we had a room, we had a meeting in a room, okay? But interesting story is this. The first kid that came to me with the idea, he disappeared, no? So he came to me with the idea and he said, to start this thing, okay? He brought three of his friends. And then I called for a big meeting, okay? So about 13, 14 people turned up. And then the original kid actually didn't turn up, eh? He just dropped out, okay? So the interesting story is that the student who actually initiated this thing, he never did anything, okay? But anyway, but one of his friends did, okay? So one of his friends that came joined me. So after meeting them, okay, we decided to do this. And the truth is this, it is not easy to build software. And I didn't think that we could build software on a part-time basis. So the idea was to spend summer, right, the 3 months over summer, to build a software, which is what I did at MIT. So I actually spent, it was quite crazy at that point because I took 3 months off my studies, right? And they spent whole summer building software for the Salvation Army. Why did I do that? Actually, I still don't know to today, but that's what I did. All right, so the problem, however, is this. The problem, many of the 13, 14 students, they were international students. Right, so they were here in Singapore for on scholarship, and they're not rich, lah, right? So if they stayed and built software over the summer, right, there's a problem, which is how would they pay for food and lodging, right? So what happened? So remember this 2006, right? I was full-time prof, okay, but I became a part-time beggar. So I decided, okay, I want to do this. So what do we do? So I had to go around. Ask for money. How many of you have asked? I mean, how many of you raised money? Or try to, okay, small number of you. Do you sir names? Can I have your name, sir?
Leo.
Okay. So sorry, I didn't get it right.
Leo,
right? Yeah. Leo, okay. So question, did you enjoy raising money?
I mean, it was for a humanitarian.
Humanitarian project. Okay. Do people enjoy giving you money? Well, anyway, I mean, the nut of the story is this, right? It's actually difficult to raise money, okay? I suspect I was more handsome when I was younger, okay? But even then, nobody gets up in the morning wanting to give me money, right? So raising money is a real pain, okay? But nevertheless, interestingly, the thing that I want to share with you is sometimes in life, right? I actually didn't know how to raise money, okay? I just did it shamelessly. I just went around asking whoever I could ask. And actually, interestingly, I raised the money, okay? So basically, I raised about 20,000 or something, okay? And we actually had a project, okay, in 2007. So the year after I came back to Singapore, I had a team of, I forget, it was like 12 students or so, and then we built software, right? So this is one of the things that we first built in 2007, okay? So what this is in Singapore, there are these little outfits, okay? Social outfits called Neighborhood Links, okay? What happens is that the government has sort of like set up this centers at different estates, right? Whereby the old folks, old people, can go there to do things, right? So basically, there was a neighborhood link whereby, so this is what it sort of looks like. Okay, so there is actually a counter in the center, okay? And what they did was that they originally had this kind of membership cards, which you see on the table with the photo. So when these old folks go to the center, they'll put their cards on this board thing to kind of like, take attendance, right? Because the point is that this neighborhood links are funded by the government. So every like 3 months, they need to submit a report on who turns up for the funding purposes. So what we did was that we actually built for them a barcode scanning system, whereby instead of using, instead of leaving a card on the counter for the staff to take attendance, they actually scan their membership card and then they have this touch screen. So this is what you see, right? So this neighborhood link is a place whereby the old folks actually go in there to do things and have enjoy facilities. So you have massage chairs, you have a computer, you have got foot bath, hand massage, karaoke, they have that too, when old folks like to sing. Then you have some exercise machines. So the point is that they go there to enjoy the services and then they kind of take off attendance because these centers need to report the statistics. So that's what we built for them. Alright, and okay, then there's the other client we had in the first year was this place called Minds, right? Minds is what is it called? Movement for the Intellectually Disabled of Singapore. So they deal with people who are intellectually disabled. Okay, and these days you may not know this, but back in those days, right? If you travel by Singapore Airlines, okay, when you get on the plane, they give you these earphones. Not earphones, sorry, it's just headphones, right? And so you use the headphones, you toss it into a bag, right? After you leave the plane. And what happens is that they actually send all these headphones to this center in Mainz where these intellectually disabled people would then clean the headphones and repack it. Okay, so as a form of like social enterprise. So I think that, unfortunately, I think this is gone now because today, you know, it's all disposables. It's very sad, right? But back then, you had this reusable headphones. And the point is that, so this clients of this center, what they do is they actually do work there, right? And then they get paid, okay? So what the center needed was, I mean, in the past was they need to have a book and then they take attendance every day and figure out how much they need to pay. And at the end of the month, they figure out how much to pay each of the clients. Okay, but what we did was we built for them this system, which effectively took attendance. So every day, the person who is this chap here, okay, in the past, they used a book like this, a kind of file, to take attendance to figure out who turned up for work every day. Now, with the new system, he instead of like putting the collecting the data in paper, he actually used a PC to record all the information. Now, for what this does is that at the end of the month, all right, our system will automatically compute the payments to the clients. It will track everything, right? So what we did was we built the system to support them in doing this thing. Now, so these are the clients that we've worked with over the last 15, 16 years, okay? And currently, okay, some of them have, you know, projects have ended, and we have, I'll tell you a bit more about that later, but right now we have 4 clients, okay? But even though there's just 4 clients, it's actually much more than that. So these are the projects we've done over the years. We kind of have recorded everything we've done, okay? And actually, 2017, we had our 10th anniversary. Okay, so today, to date, we have built about 12 to 13 systems for different organizations. So the question is, why is it 15 years, only 12, 13 systems? Because many of the systems that we built, we enhance over time. Many clients, in fact, some of the clients we work with for many, many years. For example, Lions and Frienders, one of the clients, we've been working with them since 2009. So today is 2023, right? So yeah, we've been working there for 14 years, right? So the point is that right now, among the 12, 13 systems we've built, right, 4 are still currently maintained. Okay, but interestingly, although 4 clients, right, there are many centers. So Care Corner, Line Defenders, they are all very, very big VWOs. So today, about 250 students have gone through the program. Every summer, we build software, okay? And in fact, so we have another client, this one, which is Children's Aid Society has come in last year, so we have actually finally monitored that. Right, so basically this is a kind of a sheet, I mean this is a dashboard of the system health that we can maintain. So every system that we run, there's a little an analytics dashboard. I can check the health of the system, so you can see that most of the times they you know, they work weekdays, weekends, there's kind of like resting, right? So far, I started raising about 30K a year. To date, we have expanded the program significantly. I raised probably $1 million already. Okay, but interestingly, okay, what happens is this: I raise money to pay for the stipends for the students over the summer. So I used to pay them about $1,000 a month. Okay, for food and lodging. But in return, I think we have delivered like millions of dollars of IT services value to the clients. So basically what happens is that donors will, you know, give us the funds. So our beneficiaries actually don't pay a cent, right? But we do then deliver software services for them, okay? We always deliver, I'm proud to say we never failed so far. Okay, there's one case where there was an interesting story. One year we went in there a summer, we tried to build a system. Actually didn't quite work. Okay, I'll tell you why. Because on paper, it's not really simple, right? It was some kind of attendance taking system, and we went in there trying to build it. But unfortunately, the problem with our line of work is that oftentimes, the clients don't tell you exactly what they need. So we built them what they wanted, or we thought they wanted, and it didn't quite work. Then we realized there's a problem. But the next year, we went back in, and then we understood the problem very well, and we kind of fixed it and we built it. So it was okay. Right, okay, so another interesting story of this home business is that, okay, you all know this, I mean, I just recovered from COVID. I hope most of you are okay. But COVID happened in 2020, right? Okay, and anybody recalls what happened in May 2020? Anybody remember? How many of you were in Singapore in 2020? Not in Singapore, right? Okay, so let me tell you what happened in 2020. So when COVID first happened, right, Singapore was like gold standards, right? Everything was really going really well, right? Okay. In May 2020, was when we had the first outbreak in the dorms, okay, foreign worker dorms. Okay, and frankly, this is when we went into this circuit breaker, which is lockdown, right? So in May 2020, times are really hard, things are really bad, right? Because COVID is kind of raising our control. And at that point in time, you know, the Ministry of Health was actually in charge of running the ops. But it was so bad that what they did, okay, like many places in the world, they called an army. So the army was called in to kind of solve this problem. Okay, and basically what happened in the army is this, okay? So let me tell you another story about COVID. Okay, there was this other thing called SARS, right? It's like 2009 or 2008 something, right? So SARS was actually the previous, like, I wouldn't call it pandemic. I mean, after COVID, you don't call SARS a pandemic, but it was a real concern, right? And about 12, okay, the difference between COVID and SARS is that I think SARS, in SARS, I think about 200 odd people were sick. Some died, but 200 over were sick. And after SARS in 2008-2009, right, the government had this protocol for contact tracing. Okay, they have a protocol because, you know, after something bad happens, in Singapore, we have these plans. If the same thing happens, what do we do? Now, it turns out that in the contact tracing protocol for SARS, okay, what they did was that they have one spreadsheet for every patient. So you can imagine, so every person that they found was sick, right? There's one spreadsheet which contains the information. Okay, so what happens when you are found to be sick, right? Okay, for SARS and for COVID, is that somebody, okay, will call you up and ask you, what have you done every day of the week for the last 2 weeks? Okay, so I don't know how people can remember what they did for the last 14 days, but technically you're supposed to tell the officer calling you what you have done, where you have been, who you have seen for the last 14 days. Okay, and they record all these things in a spreadsheet. Now, in SARS, right, there were only 200 odd people over like 2 years, right? So, or something like that. It's a very small number. So basically one spreadsheet per person is actually okay. But when you talk about COVID in 2020 May, we were talking about 800 to 1,000, I think, people infected every day. Because now it's more and nobody cares, but back then it was really serious, right? So basically, you can imagine, right, every day there's like 800 spreadsheets, okay? And at a point in time, there were they set up about 7 contact tracing centers all over Singapore. There are about 100 contact tracers working every day from 10 to 10. Okay, I guess if you call people up earlier than 10 o'clock in the morning, they get upset at you. So they start at 10 in the morning and they end at 10 p.m., right? So there are this 100 people who will call people who are sick, right? And they have about 800 spreadsheets every day, new spreadsheets, you know, email around, right? So there were some mistakes here and there. There were like people who were not called, there were people who were called by 2 centers, okay? So what happened was that SAF decided that, hey, we can't do this anymore. We need to build a full-fledged IT system, which is what we did. So they tried to do it, and then, you know, they have time or whatever. They called me up, okay? And what happened in that summer of May 2020 is that I had a group of students under this program. These guys are the guys that you see there. And we actually built the national contact tracing system. So they didn't give me a little thing, right, to thank us for this effort. So we were actually part of the national, you know, efforts to fight COVID back then. Okay, so the question is, you know, how do we do more? Okay, so we've done this for the last 15, 16 years, I lost track, 15 years, yeah, maybe. Okay, turns out that let me explain to you what is the current landscape of the social service agencies in Singapore. Right, so, okay, formerly they were called VWOs, Volunteer Welfare Organizations. So this is how I would, you know, show you what the landscape looks like. Okay, currently these are our clients that we work with, okay? And it turns out that we are working with very big clients. Because the truth is that, I mean, it sounds simple, but we're building really sophisticated IT systems. And frankly, only the very big organizations that have like, you know, $10 million turnover, you know, hundreds of clients actually need such systems. If you are a small-time social service SSA, right, you probably just need a spreadsheet or Excel spreadsheet or something. Right, so it doesn't actually make sense for us to kind of like work with them, not big scale enough. Right? But the truth is that we have been approached by other smaller agencies. Right, so the problem is that how do we help these smaller agencies? So there are a few things that we have done. Okay, first of all, we have put out a little volunteer site, okay, whereby, you know, this small charities can put up jobs that our students can go look and work with them. We have actually given out fellowships to students to work with this agency. So the idea is that it's just like in this CVWO program, whereby we give like small summer stipends so that students can work full time on building IT projects. We also give out fellowships that they can do projects with these small charities. Okay. Now, there's another thing that we're doing soon, which is that we are going to also set up, hopefully, in a few months or by next year, what we call a Tech for Good adoption system. So basically, we're going to start this group of students, right? And there will be a lot of demand because there are most of these agencies have needs to like digitize and do, you know, some IT services. So we'll have some students that will adopt them, right? Okay, so they will serve as kind of consultants or advisors to these organizations. And this is one thing we'll do, and potentially you can find them under the public services fellowships as well. And maybe, okay, they can manage outsourcing if charities need to like build software, right? They can also manage outsourcing for them. And the last thing that we're doing is actually building this project called the Project Cornerstone. Okay. So what is the point, right? So in the right side of the picture, we are building custom systems, huge custom systems for these big BWOs. But for the small BWOs or small SSAs, right, it actually doesn't make sense to build these big custom systems. So this new project, which is called Project Cornerstone, will be a kind of a big mothership system whereby, you know, many organizations in the future will share the same base system, okay? But to support each of their own specific ops, right, we will build special modules on them. So this is something that we are going to be doing soon. Okay, so this is, and my CVWO group will be actually be building this this new project this coming summer. All right, so yeah, and then of course, these days we are quite, sorry, I was too fast. We also actually have improved our security services. So now our systems actually support 2FA, two-factor. Okay, anyway, so what I'm sharing with you is this, it's how at NUS our students are providing pretty much real and concrete assistance to the social services sector, okay? And what we have done is that we give them an opportunity, right, to apply their tech skills, okay, before they graduate, right, to do good, okay? And actually, this is one thing that I have come to realize. Singapore is a rather rich country, to be honest, right? And actually, many of our students actually don't know what poverty looks like. You know, they actually don't know. Many have never seen prior to coming to NUS. Okay, by actually working with these charities, I think that it helps them to see the world as it really is, right? And you know, improve empathy and understanding of you know, the underprivileged in society. So I think that helps. Okay, so I'm about to end. So sorry. So that before you can ask questions, right? So we have done this for 15 years, I lost track. Okay. So what are lessons that we have learned? Okay. So first of all, the social services sector is like a zoo. I mean, so we started off, okay, this is what we wanted to do, right? What we wanted to do was we wanted to build software one time and have the software be used by many organizations. Okay. We found it to be impossible because there are about 300 odd SSAs in Singapore, and ostensibly many of them are supposed to do the same things, but they don't do the same things. Okay, and so we found it very difficult to build one software that everybody needed and could use well. So what we have done over the years is that we have focused on serving a few of these agencies very well, make sure that we build software that meets their needs specifically. And the other thing that is really difficult about working with these agencies is that the turnover rates are really high, right? It can be up to 20% a year. So basically, for let's say line defenders, right? I've been working with them for the last, since 2009, so it's the last 13, 14 years, right? It turns out that I probably know more than the organization than the people there, right? Because I have seen four executive directors come and go, okay? Most of the staff that is there today were not there when I worked with them. So it means that this everything has changed, right? Whereas I've been around for the last 14 years. So I actually sometimes know more than the staff about the operations of their organization. So turnover is very difficult to work with, but this is a challenge that we face. Okay, and the real challenge, the real problem with working with these charities is not technology actually. Most of it is most of the problems we deal with are people problems. Okay. Sometimes there's some disconnect, right? The management wants to do this, you know, some new sometimes okay, the management has a lot of vision, you know, a lot of vision about data science, you know. But sometimes on the ground, the reality is that the ground folks actually don't care about that. You know, they want to do get the work done, right? So sometimes, you know, we learn to ignore some requests because, you know, if you do it, it's not practical. We talk to the people who actually are doing the work, right, to figure out what really needs to be done, okay? And really, a people problem is a hard problem, okay? And like I said, one of the reasons that is tech is really hard, my line is really hard, is that, well, we kind of try to support businesses, right? And oftentimes we, you know, we expect the clients to know what they want, right? But actually, half times they don't know what they want. So the real challenge, okay, in building software, okay, is not so much doing it right. Okay, so actually, to be honest, my students are quite concerned. You all know about ChatGPT, right? ChatGPT, you know, you can write poems, okay? In fact, you can write code, you know, you can write code, you can tell it, you know, write a Python program, it does this, it'll do for you. So my students have been asking also, hey, do we have a future, right? Will we be replaced by AI? Will I not have a job when I grow up? Well, so I tell them, okay, and this is important, right? Which is that what we teach them in school, mostly, is how to do the things right. Okay, so you need to write a program, and then you need to write it properly, and it must run, it must not have bugs up. But actually, when we actually do work with the clients, right, what is really important is not doing the thing right. Instead, it is doing the right thing, okay? So actually, we're much better off, okay, doing the right thing, you know, relatively well, okay well, than doing the wrong thing perfectly well, okay? And this is really challenging. So I think the future is that AI can do many things, okay? So it can help you do something right, but it will not for a long time be able to help you do the right thing, okay? And decide what the right thing is. So the point is that developing software is not the same as coding. So I tell my students, hey, we are software engineers, but our job is not to write code. I mean, not directly. Our job is to solve problems. Okay, let me tell you a story about this. So basically, we were working, I mentioned, right, we were working with this neighborhood links at first. Okay, they have, like, you saw the massage chairs, they have karaoke, right? One of the things they had was Tai Chi. You know Tai Chi, the one where the old people go there and do these things, right? So Tai Chi is not done inside the center, right? Because they need space, right? So Tai Chi is done in some field or some basketball court somewhere away, right? So when we first talked to them about their needs, right? The client said, hey, Prof, can you build us some software where we can use a laptop to take... Okay, back then, okay, to be honest, this is 20 years ago, there was no mobile phone, right? I mean, if the mobile phones, they asked me to use mobile phone, but there's no mobile phone then. So they wanted us to build them software to take attendance with a laptop. So they wanted the Tai Chi master, right, to carry a laptop to do Tai Chi. I'm like, kidding me, right? Okay, so in the end, the solution was this. The solution was not to have the Tai Chi master carry a laptop. What we did was that the system, okay, printed a name, a nominal role, a name sheet of all the people who are doing Tai Chi. The Tai Chi master goes to the center, picks up that form, that nominal role, okay, with a pencil, goes to Tai Chi, finish Tai Chi, check off the people who appeared, and pass the form to the counter person, and he goes home. Right, so there's sometimes in life it's not about building stuff to solve problems. It's about figuring out what is the right way to solve the problem and doing the right things. Right, so this is actually the key lesson for them. And another thing is this: we have many requests for systems, because we are free. I mean, we don't charge people money, right? So everybody wants a free system. So the question is, how do we decide what systems do we build, right? And I mean, which clients entertain? And let me tell you what we've decided to do, okay? we have, I've invented this thing which I call the white elephant test. Okay, so how does it work, right? So the idea is that the client comes to us, right, and tells us we want to build this system. So we imagine that we successfully build a system, okay? Then we let the client, you know, run the system for 6 months, okay? Then we ask ourselves, what happens if we suddenly take the system away, so it just disappears? Okay, if indeed the client continues business as usual, then what happens? It means that, frankly, our work is completely useless, right? Okay, so it's a white elephant. However, if we take the system away after 6 months, the client completely cannot function, then we know we've built something useful. Okay, I'm pleased to say that, okay, I mean, that I think with the systems we have currently maintained are really quite core, right? If we actually shut down the system, the clients actually cannot function. So this is something we do to for sanity check. Okay, so the another thing that I want to share with you is this, building, okay, the thought of building software for charities are really cool, and this is 15 years ago. But one thing we've found is that there are very few people who can do what we do, and the reason is very simple, because actually, building this thing is the easy part. Okay, what is really difficult and where we have done really well is that it's the maintenance. So we have worked with Lions for the last 13 years. It means that after we build a system for them, every year we go in there and maintain, upgrade the system. Okay, and this is what's really, really difficult. So I think to date, I think we're the only organization in Singapore that can do this thing on a sustained basis. And the main reason, because we have staying power. Okay, and we are able to maintain the systems that we build over time. Okay, we're building the same, building the easy part. Okay, so to end, I see most of you are foreign students, right? Okay, and this is a quote from JFK. Okay, so I want to reframe this today when I end. I think instead of thinking of this country, because Singapore is not a country, but I want to encourage you to think about how you might also, you know, work in Singapore, you know, with the local organizations, just like I did when I was in MIT for grad school 20 years ago. You know, I worked with the local Salvation Army and built this thing. Okay, and on that, I'm happy to take questions. Thank you. The man in red behind.
Do you share your softwares internationally? For example, your COVID tracking app may have been useful in other countries.
That's a good question. So the question is, have we actually shared the software internationally? Answer is no, not yet, right? Up until now, it's like I said, it's very difficult. We found that even locally, we can't really share the software, because it's not you can't solve the share the software. The problem is that most of these organizations have very specific needs, okay, and they want to do their work in a certain way, right? So frankly, you can give them software, okay. The software does things in a way that they don't like, right? They won't use it, okay. But moving forward, like I said, we're building this new project, which we've called Project Cornerstone, which is going to be a big project, okay? Longer term, once we are able to set it up, I'm happy to do this, take it national. But at this point in time, we have not done so. And there's another issue also, which is that there are very serious privacy concerns, you know, because we are managing real data, right? And there's a lot of concerns, you know, about data privacy. So at some level, we don't even share the source code. Okay, there were thoughts whereby we can actually publish the source code open source, right? But then the problem is that we are concerned that once the source code goes out, right, people will start hacking our systems, right? And then we have privacy leaks and things like that. So because we are kind of like, you know, Singapore is this thing called kiasu, so we are really afraid that things will go wrong. So we have not even shared the source code. But that's it. For all the clients that we have built software for, we actually give them full, if they want to take the system away, I will give them full access to the source code. Right. But I think that's a good point you made. We have not yet, worked internationally, but it's a good idea. Maybe, you know, someday we will go international, especially today. Okay, so in the past, let me say something else. In the past, before COVID, our work was all done in person, obviously, right? But actually, the last 3 years has been interesting because we can't meet, right? Okay? So we have been doing a lot of work online. So I think with this new move towards online work, right, I think it's something we can consider. You know, that means instead of working with just organizations in Singapore, we can also work with charities and NGOs globally. I think it's possible. But there are a lot of challenges because to do this work well, you do need to have some access to the clients. So made up so easy overseas, but that's something that we have not thought about doing. Maybe we'll do this soon. Thank you. Anybody else? Next. Yes, sir. Leo, right? Okay. Yes. You can just speak. I can try to hear you. All right.
So my question will be regarding, the white elephant, as you mentioned in the end. So if you build a good system, the organization relies upon it. How do you ensure that it properly works for the long term? So how do you deal with long-term risk, basically? For example, as I imagine, some year students dry up, there's not any more interest. How do you deal with that? Because then the organizations rely on your system. And maybe in that sense, would it be, for example, be an option to broaden up this organization, open it up to also non-NUS students or just to volunteers more in general? That would, I imagine there's more people savvy with software that would like to help out in such a project.
Leo, that's an excellent question. So in case some of you didn't catch the question that Leo mentioned is, how do we, achieve long-term risk management, okay? You're right, okay. So obviously, so this is a very good point, and it's something about life that I teach my students, which is that life is hard, right? So if what you build is useless, then we're very sad, but there's no risk, right? Because it's useless, right? But on the other hand, you're right. So today, the four organizations that I mentioned, I think if you shut down today, they can't work at all. So actually, what I have introduced, unfortunately, is what you call a key man race, which is me. Okay. So today, sadly, if I do get run by a truck, I think they're in trouble. So to be honest, this is one of the things that I've been thinking about. How do we ascertain that long term is okay? Now, in terms of the day-to-day running and maintenance, as long as I'm alive, I'm quite good at it. I've done it for 15 years. After 15 years, you figure it out. You don't figure it out, you're dead, right? So it's fine. So the problem now is, yes, I must say that sometimes in life, you sort of make mistakes. Okay? No? As in, this one of the mistakes, which is I have created myself as a key man risk for these organizations. I think what I'm trying to do quite desperately is to find a successor or number two, right? So if I get run by a truck, right, then somebody will take over. But honestly, there's another thing that's interesting, which is that after working with these organizations for a whole summer, right, my students actually know them quite well. So actually on the ground today, it is my students that are actually working with the clients quite directly. And although over the summer or 3 months they do most of the work, they actually keep in contact with the clients, and the rest of the 9 months when they're in school, they actually still do quite a lot of, not that much, they do some amount of maintenance work, they do some client requests, they can handle it. So I think that if such wood, bad things happen to me, for now the students can still handle the clients. But then I think for me, if that bad thing happens, then of course I'm not around to settle it, but I think my students will work with the clients to try to figure out how to handle the transition. But you're right, okay? That's a great question for which I have been trying to find an answer for. In terms of opening up widely, I think it's not so easy because, as I said, we are not a vendor, but we are like an IT vendor somewhat, right? From them, they see us as a free IT vendor who's very competent. And the trouble here is there's a problem of trust, right? So the people that actually work on the systems, they are dealing with live data, dealing with people's information, right? At some level, we need some level of control and trust. It's not some open source thing that I can let anybody have access to the source code. So it's not so simple to just open up to non-NUS people, but I have taken a small number of non-NUS students who approach me randomly from random places over time. So this organization, I have a small number of non-NUS students, but they're all software engineers, and they come to me and say, Prof, I want to do this, can we work with you? And we do that. Okay. Sorry, I didn't give you a good answer because there is none. So in life, the lesson I want to give you is that sometimes in life, there are questions for which there are no good answers, and the prof does have all the answers. Thank you very much. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Thank you for an interesting conference. So my question was that, as you said, you started in 2002 at MIT, and back then, next door was Facebook future CEO Mark Zuckerberg, and he was also doing software engineering, and his learning was actually relying on new technologies, new way of coding, like PHP software. And for you, when you started building all these softwares, has there been a time when you envisioned the next paradigm of coding where you could actually scale all your application and build something much bigger than just local applications?
Good question. So the question is whether in 2002, right, I thought of big thing bigger, right? Well, 2002, to be honest, I was in grad school. What I was supposed to do was to work on my research and graduate. I mean, the fact that I went off to build this stuff for Social Good is a little bit crazy. Yeah, I'm a little bit crazy, as you realize. I was actually supposed to focus on graduating, not on doing random stuff. And in terms of building software, to be honest, I'm quite a good software engineer. Okay, really. And one of my biggest regrets is this, which is that, you know, I'm not sure if you remember, there was this thing called Hotmail. Is this still around? Well, I think it was Hotmail. I think it sold to Yahoo for 400 million or something, right? I could have built that. I just didn't do it in time. I mean, it wasn't that hard. Right? I mean, building software, okay. For people who know how to build software, building software is actually quite easy, right? The problem, okay, sorry, there's building software, building it well, and it's making money, right? What's the difference? Making money is about building the right software, right? I mean, if I had known that I make 400 million building Hotmail, I would have built it. I could have built it. You can trust me on that. But I just didn't know that. Didn't occur to me, right? And of course, it didn't occur to me to build Facebook, I mean, whatever, you know. But this is luck for you. So this is really what you're saying, is this is really the lesson that I mentioned earlier, which is that instead of just knowing how to build the things right, I mean, most of us are very good at building software well, okay, that's not very hard. The real question in life, and this is business school, right? Can you build the right software at the right time? All right, thank you very much. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Wait, who, sir?
Do you solely work for charities, or are there some other projects that...
do you solely work for charities, or are there some projects...
Do I only work for charities? Right now, we only work for charities because we raise money, right? Okay, and there's some accountability to our donors, right? Oh, it turns out. Currently, last 2 years, we have been adopted by GIC, which is the Singapore's National Sovereign Fund. So they fund me fully. And interestingly, they were giving me like 50K a year earlier. After we built the COVID system, they were like completely sold. This is the right thing. So they invested more money. So now we have expanded. Now we are a tier one CSR program for GIC because they have seen the value of what we do. And now we are like, in fact, they were so generous. They said, okay, don't go ask for more money. We pay you fully. We want to take over the entire sponsorship. I said, yeah, okay, very good. So now for me, money raising is quite easy because we have been proven, and then the National Sovereign Fund is now funding us. So on that basis, they give us money, right, to do stuff, and our pitch to them was that we are serving the community. So yes, all our clients have been, in fact, they're IPCs, the Institute of Public Charter, so they are actually charities that are registered under the Singapore Act, Charities Act. Yes. I don't think we'll go and do other things, because right now, there are actually infinite amount of work to be done. And so I don't think we'll do random stuff. We'll probably just focus on charities. Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Wally.
I don't think you told them what's your day job.
My day job?
You're doing this in your free time, right? So what's your day job?
I think I'm still prof. Last I checked, I still have a job at NUS. You know, I still teach at NUS. I also run a center that builds AI software for education. I do random stuff. Yeah. But this is one of the things I do. Thank you much. Thanks, Wally. Anybody else? Yes. Leo again. Yes.
Sorry, the mic is coming, so we can hear you.
Yeah, thank you.
So You said you have limited capacity, of course.
Yes.
How do you make sure you basically address the needs of charities that are actually in need? Because, for example, some of them are really strapped for cash, they would really benefit from such a system, but they're also charities that are actually quite well funded and wouldn't really need your free services, basically. So how do you make sure that nobody's taking advantage, basically?
Okay, so the point is this, right? This program is not small time, it's really big time engineering, right? So at some level, we are kind of like stuck working with the big charities. Okay, so it's not so much that the big charities have no money. In fact, the big charities have quite a lot of money, right? But you see, the thing about charities is this, right? I mean, they can raise a few million dollars of, some of the charities are working at $10 million turnover. It means they raise $10 million, they spend $10 million a year. Now, but let me tell you something about charities, right? Charities do not have, it is not easy for charities to spend money, right? Because whatever money they spend, they need to account to the board and things like that, right? So it is very difficult for, okay, so to be honest, in case you don't know this, IT is really expensive. It's really expensive these days, right? So the trouble is that, the two problems. First problem is that it's very difficult for charities, even if they raise the money, to justify building IT systems, because their donors are quite mad, right? The donors basically expect the money that they give to go to beneficiaries. Okay, if you tell the donors that, okay, you gave me $10 million, I just spent $2 million on an IT system, it's very difficult for them, number one. Number two is this, even if you're a big charity that actually has the money and is willing to spend money on IT, on software, they actually have a huge risk. So there are quite a few charities that I worked with over the years. They have this needs, ask us to build for them, we have no time. They find a vendor and they fail. Okay, it means that they actually, you know, commission a vendor to build a software system and then it doesn't work and they write off. Then those are very ugly, because you know, you essentially have burned money on the clients. So there are some structural problems. And I guess the scale of the, we work with large scale systems, so at some level we're limited to the big charities, because the small charities, frankly, like I said, many can make do with Excel. Okay? Yeah, so to be honest, am I sure that I'm serving the most needy charities? I don't know, right? Because you can't tell. But what I do know is that we are serving charities for which our services are actually appropriate and for which it's actually very, very difficult for them to be able to find a vendor of the kind of caliber that we can deliver, and also to pay for the kind of rates that would have to be charged. So definitely I'm convinced, even if I'm not like totally optimal in terms of client selection, we are doing some good on the ground. Okay? Thank you, Leo. Anybody else? Okay, about an hour is almost up.
Okay. In any case, you've always interviewed on newspaper, you're very active on Medium, so if you have any remaining question, it's very easy.
Yeah, you can Google and send me email.
Yeah.
Right, thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you much for inviting me. Have a great day.